Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting in 2023 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. First of all, I'd like to remind everyone present to switch their mobile phones to silent. The first item of business is a declaration of interests. In accordance with Section 3 of the Code of Conduct, I invite Mercedes Vialba, MSP, to declare any interests relevant to the remit of the committee.
No relevant interest, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much and welcome to the committee, Mercedes.
For having me.
Before we move on to the next item on the agenda, I'd like to take this opportunity on behalf of the committee to thank Carol Mochan, MSP, for her contribution to the committee and having worked diligently during her time with us. And I don't know that Carol Mochan, MSP, she's been in touch to pass on her thanks to everyone involved in the committee and her best wishes to the committee also going forward. So thank you very much for that, Carol. And also we'd like to wish Carol all the best in her new role. The next item of business is to decide whether to take items 5 and 6 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private?
Yeah.
Moving to agenda item number 3 today, we are taking evidence on the Trusts and Succession Scotland Bill. Can I welcome Lady Payton, who is the Chair of the Scottish Law Commission, and Lord Drummond Young, who is the Lead Commissioner and former Chair of the Scottish Law Commission. Welcome to the committee. Can I remind all attendees not to worry about turning on their microphones during the session, as these are controlled by broadcasting. And if you would like to come in on any question, please just raise your hand or indicate to the clerks. So before we move to the questions, can I first invite Lady Payton to make some brief opening remarks.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, everybody. On behalf of the Scottish Law Commission, can I thank everyone for their contribution in bringing this legislation to the stage it's at present. It's been quite a campaign and we really appreciate it. The Trusts and Succession Scotland Bill is a very much needed bill, eagerly awaited by many people, not just lawyers, I have to say, but members of the public. And that's because people have to administer trusts throughout Scotland in many fields. And while I've reminded the committee of the various areas where trusts crop up, I'll just run through one or two again. National Health Service, environmental trusts, pension administration, charitable trusts, common repairs involving tenement owners, property developers with funds reserved for snagging, business partnerships, church elders, and individual people making provision for their death by setting up a trust. And these are only a few examples. I mean, trusts permeate Scottish society, and the current legislation, this is the problem, the current legislation governing trusts is over 100 years old. The main statute was enacted in 1921, and society and business have changed considerably since then. In 1921, trusts were predominantly used for private estates, landed estates, and private funds. But now, in 21st century Scotland, trusts provide a useful tool for many public enterprises, business activities, and communal activities which are set up for the benefit of society. So trusts are hugely important, and the bill seeks to modernise them. But in addition to modernising trust law, the bill contains some provisions dealing with the disposal of an intestate person's estate on their death, the aim being to reflect more the public's expectations of who should inherit in this particular area in 21st century Scotland. So it's hoped that this bill will provide a major modernising boost to Scotland's society and economy as we emerge from the pandemic. The overall goal is to contribute towards an increasingly efficient, fair, productive and prosperous economy and society. And we're fortunate to have here today Lord Drummond Young, who was the lead commissioner when all the trust work was done at the Scottish Law Commission. So he was instrumental in bringing about the relevant report and draft bill. And we also have here, I believe, sitting behind me, although I haven't seen them yet, the bill team, I hope. from St Andrew's House, I believe headed by Michael Paparakis. So I hope we can help you in any way that is necessary to advance the cause of this bill. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lady Payton. Lord Drummond-Young, is there anything you would like to say in the record at the outset?
Well, we've been provided with a list of topics that it's understood the committee would like to be covered. I've got our treatment on each of these. I would propose simply going through those one by one. And obviously, I'll say a little bit about it, but I'm very happy to answer questions on any matter that occurs to anyone, whether it's in these topics or otherwise. Should I work my way through the list of topics in that case?
No, it's okay. We'll ask the questions and then...
Right, that's fine, yes. Yeah. Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So first of all, I'll open before handing over to some colleagues. And you said a few things there, Lady Payton, just regarding the current legislation and also with the bill in front of this committee today. But can you explain why the Commission chose a project aiming to reform the law of trusts? What genuinely were the key objectives that the Commission was seeking to achieve?
Well, I would like to give you my views on that, Convener, but I feel perhaps Lord Drummond-Young, who was taking over the project at a much earlier stage, I think 2004, is that right?
I started in 2010, I think.
2010, was aware of what driving forces were behind this project, but speaking for myself, what I've gathered is that, for example, the duties and obligations of trustees is not very clear from the bill. From the Act 1921. things have changed enormously, but things are vague about what you're supposed to be doing as a trustee. And someone like a church elder wants something as clear as possible. There was also some negativity about telling beneficiaries who were perhaps entitled to something under the trust, they didn't have any provision for releasing information to a beneficiary. So these were two things that I picked up. But I think there were considerably more than that. And I would invite Lord Drummond-Young to comment on that.
Yes, I wasn't a commissioner at the time when the project was initially adopted, but I became the lead commissioner for the latter stages of it. I think the main reason was that there is a recognition that trusts are a very important part of the law, not just in themselves, but they're a sort of adjunct to many other things, the law relating to contracts, to charities, to property law to some extent. And the main statute governing the law is the Trusts Act 1921. That, quite frankly, was out of date. It had been amended repeatedly. Many of the important sections were chaotic. It was extremely difficult to use. I can vouch this from my own experience at the bar and on the bench. I practiced in this area a lot at the bar. I went on the bench in 2001, and soon after that became the designated trust judge dealing with trusts litigation in the Court of Session. The 1921 Act was extremely difficult to use, extremely inaccessible, and the law clearly needed reform. A major function of the Law Commission is obviously to keep the law up to date, and it was thought this was an area that was crying out for fairly major updating, and that is what has happened, not just by reference to Scotland, but by reference to practice throughout the rest of the world where trusts are in use.
Okay, no, that's helpful. Thank you very much. So, Mercedes Verba.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. A key theme of the responses to the committee's call for views was that it's important that the legislation is accessible to trustees and beneficiaries without legal backgrounds. And I think, Lady Patton, you alluded to that in your opening remarks. So ideas which the committee received to enhance accessibility included drafting changes, government guidance, a publicity campaign, and template legal documents which could appear in the bill itself. So could you comment on those ideas, especially the proposal to have style or template legal documents in the legislation?
We considered this. We deal with it expressly in the Commission report. It's this fairly hefty volume here. We rejected that because there are actually very good style books available. There are a couple of these, one by Alan Barr, who teaches at Edinburgh University, and one by Kessler and Grant, who are practising. I think one is an English barrister, the other is a Scottish solicitor in this field of law. The English style book was kind of modified, but it's proper Scottish styles here. But both of these books provide styles for lawyers. There is perhaps scope for providing styles for to let lay people set up trusts. A good example of this is if you're collecting money to carry out repairs on the common stair in a tenement, you may want to put those monies into a trust account. And it would be, I think, helpful to have some sort of generally available style of trust for that, as well as instructions as to how to use it and what you have to do. This is far more detailed than could go in the Law Commission report. It's not really the sort of thing that should go in legislation, we thought. We thought that ancillary documents should be used for that purpose. I may say I'm planning to write a series of articles for the Scots Law Times or the Law Society Journal or other legal periodicals about the main changes affected by the bill, or things that may be perceived as changes even when they're not really. These, of course, are for the legal profession. As I agree entirely that it would help to bring this home to members of the public. Articles in the general press could help this, and it may be that the Scottish Government could ensure that documents are published that give guidance on how people can set up trusts for their own purposes. I would be very happy to cooperate with that if any help is required. But we felt that this is more detailed than you require in the bill. If you put too much into the bill, you get the sort of problems that you had with the 1921 Act, that they get amended and amended and amended and become almost unusable after a time. So it's better, we felt, having these documents in separate sources, either style books or perhaps styles issued by the government.
Thank you.
Okay, no, thank you. certainly, unlike the Commissioner's draft bill, this bill does not include the pension trusts in its definition of a trust. The Scottish Government intends to ask the UK Government to implement a Section 104 order. Obviously, it's something that we are very much aware of in this committee with the Movable Transactions Bill, which reaches Stage 3 on Thursday afternoon. So, with the... In terms of yourselves, would you like to give a view on the Scottish Government's approach to the request for a Section 104 order with regards to the pensions?
Well, I could perhaps just say, before Lord Drummond Young contributes there, I'm very much in favour of adopting that route. It's the safest route at present, not to run into any legislative competence possible problems, because there have been two very obvious difficulties in the past, one to do with children and one relating to trans. And there's just doubt about the leg comp, if I could put it that way, of the particular issue that we're referring to. And I would encourage a request to Westminster, which I think could be dealt with by a statutory instrument which would disapply the exclusion of pensions. And that would be very helpful. That would mean that the Act would apply directly to pension funds. So that's my view.
Yes, I agree entirely with that. I think it's of the utmost importance that pension trusts should be brought within the regime in the Act, using those powers that are available in the Scotland Act. They're actually very wide-ranging powers in the Scotland Act. I've had conversations with solicitors involved in pension schemes. Since I reached retirement age, I've been doing a certain amount of I've returned to the bar to do a certain amount of advisory work, much of that in the field of trusts and pension trusts in particular. And solicitors dealing in this area have repeatedly emphasised to me that it's absolutely essential that pension trusts should be brought within the scope of this legislation. The reason's very obvious. Pension schemes are invariably organised using the medium of a trust. There's no reason whatsoever for using any regime other than the general system of trust law. Otherwise, you have wholly unnecessary complexity. The lawyers in this area tend to move backwards and forwards between different types of trust. A lawyer is in his or her firm is a trust specialist, and they'll deal with pension trusts, they'll deal with other trusts, environmental trusts or trusts in commercial agreements. And they need to be able to move backwards and forwards with the minimum of effort, and using one scheme for all trusts is the way to achieve that. In relation to pension funds, I think I may have mentioned this previously when we appeared last time, but the amount of money held in pension scheme trusts is enormous. I think I may have mentioned the Plumbing Pensions case in the Court of Session in the early part of last year. I wrote the report for that case in our advocate, not judge capacity. Plumbing Pensions, the funds in a scheme set up for the plumbing industry throughout the UK, as it happens, amounted to about £2.3 billion. Now, in terms of pension schemes, that's not a very big one. I was informed by a solicitor about a local authority pension scheme that at that time contained assets amounting to £39 billion, which gives you an idea of the very large amounts of money that are contained in these pension scheme trusts. And with increased longevity, they're going to get increasingly important. And we did consider it essential that at least with Scottish employers and Scottish scheme providers, they should be governed by Scots law.
With regards to the issue of the pension trusts and the potential Section 104 order, have you had any dialogue at all thus far with the Scottish Government on that particular matter?
Well, there is dialogue proceeding. I understood it to be with Westminster. In fact, just give me a moment. Where is the dialogue? Is it between and Westminster? Yeah. Yes, I believe the government is communicating with Westminster. So we could send further details about who has been corresponding with whom, if that would assist.
Yeah, I think that would be helpful, thank you.
Yes, well, we undertake to do that then. Yes. But it is in the middle of negotiations just now. Yes.
Sure. Okay, no, that's helpful, thank you.
Right.
Thank you. Okay, over to Oliver.
Hi, thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask about the codification of trust law. Both the Law Society and the Scottish Law Agents Society had said their support of the bill overall, but they'd expressed a kind of regret that it wasn't a complete codification of trust law. And I was interested, and I guess for the committee's benefit, to understand what you saw as the drawbacks of attempting a full codification.
Yes, this is something we obviously considered at the time when we were preparing the report and finalising the Commission's draft bill. I mean, codification is a slightly ambiguous word. In a sense, the present bill is a codification, at least in the areas that have traditionally been regulated by statute, with the addition of some others. But the Law Commission decided against legislation in some areas, in particular those relating to stating the underlying nature of a trust in Scots law. This is a subject that's attracted a bit of academic interest in recent years. It's an area where Scots law differs radically from English law. English law is in this area is based on a dual system of law and equity. You've got the basic system of law, and starting in the Middle Ages, superimposed on that is a system known as equity. Trusts are a product of equity, not of the basic common law. Now, we don't have anything like that, I'm happy to say. It leads to, really, I think, very considerable complexity and confusion in the system. But the trusts have existed in Scotland since the Middle Ages. They've worked well enough. No one really thought much about how the underlying conceptual structure of them as a matter of theory. This changed in the 1990s with a series of articles, starting with Professor George Gretton of Edinburgh University, who was a law commissioner for a time, and followed by Professor Kenneth Reid, also at Edinburgh University, another law commissioner. They came up with what is generally known as the dual patrimony theory. There are, in a trust, this is the key to what a trust is. There is a trust patrimony, if you like to think of it as a ring-fenced fund, that's perhaps the best way of putting it, that is separate from the trustee's own patrimony. A trustee has his or her own private property, his or her own patrimony, and also controls the trust patrimony, and these are separate. This is important because if, the trust becomes insolvent, the trustees are protected from liability for the insolvency. Likewise, if a trustee becomes insolvent, the trust patrimony is protected. The funds are ring-fenced. This is one of the reasons that they're used so much in the pensions area, for example, so that the funds are ring-fenced and earmarked for the provision of employees' pensions and aren't going to be affected by the any financial difficulties the employer might have. That we decided that basic theory had been quite well explained in academic articles and has been taken up in case law since. I've been the judge in some of those cases explaining how the dual patrimony theory works, and we didn't think it was necessary to put that into the bill. It's quite a difficult thing to put in the bill because it's a kind of abstract theoretical analysis of what a trust is. You'll find the same thing in other systems. Generally, the underlying conceptual structure of the trust isn't the subject of legislation. In addition to that, there are not all trusts are express trusts. There are implied trusts. For example, they can come into existence with, say, a partnership, or sometimes in agency relationships, and these implied trusts are, again, are the court will hold that they're implied in particular circumstances. It's very difficult to put that sort of thing into legislation. There's yet a third type, the constructive trust, which is a non-express trust that's imposed by law, by a court, as a form of remedy following, say, a breach of trust. If a trustee commits a breach of trust and obtains some what should have been trust property as a result, the court may hold that he or she holds that property on a constructive trust for the same purposes as the original trust, or for the or the partnership, or whatever. We felt it was going to be too complicated to put all of these things into legislation. There was, in addition to that, quite a considerable academic debate about matters such as constructive trusts, and the case law is still developing in that area. We felt it was just a bit too early to put it all into a code, and in fact that there is not really any need to put it into a code. I think I'm right in saying that the codes that you find in other countries, the Article 9 of the Uniform Commercial Code in the United States, which touches on this area, you won't find an absolutely comprehensive definition of what a trust is. So we didn't feel you had to go that far. And again, with implied and constructive trust, the law was still developing. It was very hard to encapsulate that in legislation that would be easy to apply. The concepts are there. They are used regularly. And in a sense, it's common sense. But we thought it was better to leave matters as they are and let these areas develop as they are developing. It's really the areas that have traditionally been dealt with by legislation, which are very extensive, and some additions, for example, private purpose trusts or the power of the court to alter trust purposes, where we felt that what is effectively a code with some omissions was desirable, and that's what we've tried to provide here.
So, yeah, maybe that just to kind of be absolutely clear. I mean, it's a deliberate approach to...
It's a deliberate approach, yeah. I mean, this is pretty much a code, but it's there are one or two bits left out, but for good reason, because the law was still developing in these areas and wasn't just as clear as it might be. And quite frankly, it works well enough in practice. In these areas, it's the stuff that's the subject of legislation where the big defects existed.
Okay, no, thank you for that. And then I wanted also just to ask about the kind of role of the Court of Session compared to local sheriff courts. I know that there are some kind of expanded powers for sheriff courts, but it was to kind of I'm really looking for you to explain the policy thinking around retaining the sheriff court as the main court for the bill. Court session, given it's traditionally more expensive and less geographically accessible.
Well, I think the all courts obviously have their normal responsibility for interpreting and applying legislation. So that applies in cases about a range of subjects in Court of Session or Sheriff Courts, as the case may be. There are a number of specific powers in the bill. At a general level, these are divided into powers of an essentially administrative nature, where jurisdiction is conferred both in the Court of Session and the Sheriff Court, and more specialised powers, which usually involve considerable elements of judgment and discretion, which are conferred on the Court of Session alone. This was a deliberate policy choice. The reason for conferring the latter jurisdiction on the Court of Session is that the issues that are involved are generally rather technical and call for considerable expertise and experience in the law of trusts. In the Court of Session, a judge is designated as the trust judge. I was the trust judge for about 15 years, and it's likely that he or she will deal with the great majority of the more technical trust work. Under the bill, this will now be done in the outer house. Much trust work was previously done in the inner house, but most will now be done in the outer house by the designated trust judge and using procedures similar to those that have been developed in the commercial court. This involves a high level of case management, including in every case documents known as statements of issues, which set out in detail the issues on which the court is expected to come to a decision. That procedure has been very successful in the commercial court, and in the course of that procedure, it could be expected that the counsel and solicitors acting will be specialised in the field of trust law. This is just a recognition of the technical and often very complex nature of the issues that arise in many trust cases. As far as I can see, in nearly every jurisdiction where trusts are recognised, trusts are given to a limited number of courts and ideally to judges with expertise in trust law. There is a further problem that can arise in relation to the sheriff court, which is determining which particular court has jurisdiction. A trust doesn't have legal personality, and the trustees may live in various parts of the country, that's commonplace, or they may live outside Scotland. If they live in several different sheriff court jurisdictions, or some are outside Scotland, which is not unusual, there's a question as to which sheriff court would have jurisdiction. This problem is avoided by conferring jurisdiction on the trust judge in the Court of Session, which, as I say, accords with most of the present practice. As far as the sheriff court's concerned, there is a default provision that if the there is no obvious sheriff court with jurisdiction over the trust, Edinburgh Sheriff Court is the default jurisdiction. And really that that's just no more accessible than the Court of Session. On the whole, we thought that the Court of Session was quite accessible in cases of this sort. One thing to bear in mind is that even if the beneficiaries of the trust are in, let's say, some part of the Highlands, very often you'll find the solicitors dealing with the affairs of the trust are based in Edinburgh. So it's not the accessibility problem, I think, can easily be exaggerated. I'm quite happy to go through the particular provisions dealing with the jurisdiction of the courts. There are about 15 or 20 sections where that happens, but the general division is between the ones conferring administrative powers For example, Section 1 dealing with the appointment of additional or new trustees by the court, where they, the Sheriff Court is given the power, or Section 6, the removal of a trustee by the court for unfitness of various sorts. That again is the Sheriff Court. On the other hand, there are other powers which are more specialised, where it's the Court of Session, ultimately the trust judge there, or trust judges it may be in future, who are given jurisdiction. These involve things like orders relieving trustees of the consequences of ultra vires actings or actings in breach of fiduciary duty, at sections 29 and 32. There it's Court of Session, because these are highly technical areas where a strong element of discretion and judgment is involved. Section 43 is another, an application for an order requiring the fulfilment of the purposes of a private purpose trust. Again, that's a specialised area. Section 44, an application to reform a private purpose trust. That corresponds to the existing CPRED jurisdiction in relation to public purpose trusts. And that has nearly always been applied by judges of the Court of Session. That is where the trust judge can be expected to develop expertise and provide the sort of service to the public and the profession that one expects the courts to provide. I can go through all the sections. I've got a list of them here, but generally speaking, the division is between the ones which are of an essentially administrative nature, which are given to the Sheriff Courts, and the ones which are more concerned with detailed provisions of the law of trusts and the way they operate, and which involve very considerable discretionary elements, where it was felt that really these had to be handled with a degree of expertise and in a consistent manner throughout Scotland.
Just before we continue, Oliver, so just can I just ask one supplementary, a brief supplementary, just in terms of the if a trust is to be looked at, can you clarify just what the process would be as to whether it would then be dealt with in the Court of Session as compared to what's proposed in the bill, as to whether it would go to a Sheriff Court?
The standard grounds of jurisdiction in the Sheriff Court would have to exist, and there can be a problem here, as I say, if the trustees are spread about the country, because the trust is no separate legal personality. With a company, you can always go to the jurisdiction where it's incorporated or where it has an actual place of business. With a partnership, similarly, with a trust, it's much more vague than that. And that's why really there has to be one court dealing with it, hence the provision for the Edinburgh Sheriff Court as the default Sheriff Court, if you want to litigate that way. It is quite hard with a trust because of the because of its basic nature. I mean, it's difficult to see you can do anything about that. We've dealt with it as well as we can, and I mean, quite frankly, we didn't feel that there was going to be any significant disadvantage in having the Court of Session deal with these matters. It's not actually more expensive than the Sheriff Court. It's a bit of a myth that the Sheriff Courts are much cheaper, and especially in cases where the solicitors are in Edinburgh or Glasgow, where the majority of trust cases actually originate from solicitors in these cities, it's just as handy as the Sheriff Court.
Okay, no, thank you for that. So, Oliver?
Thank you. I just kind of wondered, following on from that, whether you kind of expect, as a result of the bill, that there'll be more kind of legal action, or if the bill's got the potential to reduce kind of litigation, and just round sort of capacity within the Sheriff Court to deal with cases.
I think that the answer to that is there could well be an increase in litigation to begin with. That's pretty standard with most acts, as any obscurities or ambiguities get decided. On the whole, I think it would. I think it gives greater certainty in most of the law. What it may do is to make Scotland a more attractive trust jurisdiction, which means that there may well be more trust business in Scotland. At present, there are stories that one hears that a certain amount of trust business originating in Scotland actually goes off to England because there's a perception that that it's dealt with greater expertise there, and the legislation is, well, it's said is kept up to date better. I'm not sure that that's right, actually, but although there is likely to be a trust bill in the at Westminster dealing with English trusts in the fairly near future, I gather the English Law Commission is looking at this. So there could well be an increase in overall trust business in Scotland, not just in court but elsewhere.
This may be an unfair question, but do you think there's sort of sufficient capacity and expertise to handle that?
I think there is, yes. Yes, there are plenty of experienced trust solicitors and advocates who specialise in trusts. And as far as the Court of Session is concerned, I'm well aware of judges with great expertise in trust law, Lord Tyre, for example, who was actually the commissioner responsible for some of the earlier stages of this project. There are other judges that definitely have good expertise in trust law. Lord Doherty, who dealt with the plumbing pensions case, is another one. I don't think there's a shortage of ability there.
Thank you.
No, thank you. Jeremy.
And just for my follow-up, one of the responses we received was the law of mediation, and there's nothing within the bill for that to happen. And I wonder, did the Commission consider a formal law for mediation? And if so, what policy considerations were given for not to include that into the bill? So rather than having to go to the Court of Session and Reserve Court to allow mediation to be a first stepping stone?
Yes, we didn't consider mediation basically because we feel that it's a matter of procedure rather than a matter of trust law. Mediation is quite important. There's nothing to prevent people from adopting mediation procedures in relation to anything in the bill, but it's really a matter of the procedures you follow in litigation or prior to litigation. The legal advisors in a trust dispute can quite readily go to a mediator, and nothing we put in the bill could really change that. The extent that there's legislation on mediation, it's on procedure rather than on the substantive law of trusts, and we didn't want to overcomplicate the bill unduly by taking in stuff from other parts of the law. On the whole, there's not very much on court procedure in this. We leave that to the basic statutes and statutory instruments dealing with procedure.
Thank you. I'll leave that there. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. And Mercedes.
Thank you. So the term incapable is defined in section 75 of the bill, and it's similar to the one used in the Adults with Incapacity Scotland Act. And in response to the committee's call for views, the Law Society noted that the Scottish Mental Health Review has recommended significant changes to capacity law in Scotland. And that would include removing the term mental disorder and moving from a capacity test to one of an ability to make an autonomous decision. So the Law Society has suggested to the committee that the Trust and Succession Bill needs to be future-proofed in case any changes to incapacity law later occur related to that Scottish Mental Health Review. So we'd be interested to hear your comments on the need for future-proofing, if it's something that you think needs to be done, and if so, what your thoughts are on how that future-proofing could be achieved.
Future-proofing is it's always difficult because it's so hard to make predictions about the future. Don't know what form to amend the definition in section 75 of the Act. It's difficult to know how we could do that now, because we don't know what the future legislation is likely to say. In future, it should be possible to make provision for amendment of this, but quite frankly, we had to go on the best definition that we had available to us, and that's what we have in the in the bill. I think future-proofing really requires further legislation. There are legislative techniques you can use for that, it's very difficult for me to comment on this because the Commission was not asked to do that kind of thing.
Thank you. So just as a supplementary to that, could a short amendment be added to that particular section so that at some point in the future, potentially, it could be amended via a statutory instrument? In terms of the definition?
Yes, there would be no problem at all with that. That I think, would be the obvious way to deal with this.
Right. OK. Well, thank you. Anything else from cities?
That's it. Thank you.
OK. Thank you. And Bill Kidd.
Yes, thank you, Convener. trustees can remove a fellow trustee under Section 7 on the basis that such a trustee is incapable and has become so. A trustee doesn't then get to participate in trust decisions under Section 12 where they are incapable, and maybe more understandably if they're untraceable. Now, the possible risk of abuse of these provisions by trustees has been highlighted by some of the responding to the call for views, such as Gillespie McAndrew. Can you highlight any safeguards in the bill as it stands or elsewhere in trust law already, which would guard against this risk? And do you actually still see some merit in these concerns?
I can see that there is some merit in the concerns. In a case where trustees abuse the power in Section 7 to remove one of their number, the person who is removed can challenge their decision in court. There's no difficulty about that. Any decision can be challenged in court, and I would emphasise the generality of that right to go to court. This really is why we didn't see there was any need for particular protections here. There is, in addition to that, there is, of course, power in Sections 1 and 2 of the Act that allows incapable, untraceable trustees to be removed by the court. In a doubtful case, that is the procedure you would use, I think. There are cases where the reasons are very, very obvious, but that these may be the more common ones, but I think most of the grounds for removal are fairly clear. Incapable is the one that the doubt is about. The others, convicted of an offence involving dishonesty, is perhaps fairly obvious, and the ones that follow that.
Capacity here, then, I suppose, is it?
Mental incapacity. Incapable is defined. It's in Section 75. That's what we've just been discussing. That may require to be amended, and I'd agree that if the general legislation in this area is amended, then this bill should be amended accordingly. But until we know what these amendments are going to be, it's very difficult to amend the bill. Yeah. A statutory instrument to allow that to take place immediately would be the ideal way of doing that.
I was wondering, within the structure of the bill as presented. Whether a trustee would find it possible without having to reach the stage where going to court was necessitated, whether there would be challenges built in to anyone being dealt with in such a manner?
If there is a challenge, the way to do it is to make an application to the court.
That's
this
the
is why
way.
You want easy procedures for that, to enable the court to come to a decision fairly quickly.
Right. Well, that makes sense. Thank you very much, Donna. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. And Mercedes.
Thank you. The Law Society and the academic lawyer Yvonne Evans have suggested that, in view of Scotland's increasing emphasis on net zero goals, that Section 16 and 17, in relation to trustees' powers of investment, that could be amended to allow trusts to adopt environmentally friendly investment policies, particularly when these might underperform compared to other investments. Does the Commission have a view on that suggested amendment?
The Commission didn't have any particular view. I have dealt with this sort of issue in a talk that I gave at a conference on this area. I don't think there is any particular bar at present to taking environmental considerations into account in investment. I think I've got the text of the talk that I delivered on this, and I think it is possible to, given the existing powers, to take environmental considerations properly into account as part of the power of the general power of investment. I don't think it's to be construed as a power to maximise returns at all costs. And it requires the trustees to take proper professional advice, of course, and to take due care in considering their investments. But there is nothing in that to prevent environmental considerations from being taken into account. In addition to that, in relation to the decision to purchase any particular investment, it's very... it would be very hard to show that an investment was unprofitable just because it was made on environmental grounds. Usually you have a choice of possible investments, and choosing the one that's best environmentally is often a sensible thing to do. You can't show that it's wrong. That's the important point. Beyond that, I wouldn't have any particular objection to including a provision about this. But there is a danger that trustees can sometimes be go a bit too far about this. I'm a trustee of a large charitable trust. This is my experience as a trustee, where the a body on which the trustees were not represented, but which has a certain jurisdiction over the charitable trust, decided that a group of trusts should get rid of all their investments in companies interested in oil and other fossil fuels. That was done just in an unthinking way, without any phasing out, and this has produced a very bad investment return in that year. Had I been asked about it, I would have said, by all means, move to that, but do it in a sensible manner, phase out the investments properly. And so there's really no absolute right and wrong in this. Yes, the general policy of phasing out fossil fuels, to take that as an example, is, I think, quite compatible with existing trustees' duties, but it should be done in a sensible way so that a shock isn't delivered to the trust.
And so although there's nothing to prevent environmental investments, would it be possible to have a kind of clarifying amendment just to make clear that maximising financial returns is not the only permissible criterion?
Something of that sort could be inserted into Section 17, which deals with the exercise of the power of investment. That does refer expressly, for example, in 17.1a2. Well, look at 17.1a. 1 is the suitability to the trust of the proposed investment. That means, for example, that let's say the trust fund of a charity to set up to achieve a particular purpose, they can avoid investing in a company that is antithetical to that. The classical example of this is in trustees set up for the purpose of the Catholic Church. They don't invest in companies that have an interest in abortion and other procedures that are forbidden by Catholic canon law. That's just one example. There are many others like that. This applies, I think, to nearly all charities. It would be the suitability of the trust of the proposed investment does permit that sort of decision to be made. A2 deals with the need for diversification. That's a general investment point. And 1B deals with taking proper advice. Nothing in this prevents taking environmental considerations into account. If you want to add something specific, I think you would add it as part of section 17. You'd have to be careful about how it was framed. As I say, the trust reported on this matter, I think 8 years ago, before people became so concerned with environmental issues. As I say, I have delivered a talk on the environmental issues since then. I have the text of that talk. If you were interested in receiving that, I could make it available.
Yes, please.
I'll do that. As I say, I don't think it's a serious problem at present, but you could put something in expressly authorising this. I might add a covering note there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Jeremy.
What if I could just follow up that point slightly with you, and that is around the trust getting best financial benefit for the trust. If it is meeting other charitable needs, is that enough? And does that need to be expressed a bit more clearly in the bill so that if a trust is, say, a charitable trust, but it always feels it's going to get best value in regard to investments or property sales, does that need to be clarified slightly?
This is the topic that I considered to some extent in the talk that I'm talking about. It was a conference last year, I think, which strangely enough was organised by the Swedish embassy, but here in Edinburgh. It's actually not Swedish, the Swiss embassy, but here in Edinburgh. I think the law is reasonably clear at present, but a provision could be put into the bill there. I'd be very happy to cooperate in devising some sort of amendment to it that permits this. The bill team would have to do it initially, and it is very important to have careful instructions about exactly what you would want to be added to the bill, what topics you would want to be covered there.
That's helpful, and thank you for your kind offer. If I can move you on now in regard to an issue that's been raised by one of the legal firms, and it concerns section 19 of the bill on nominees as currently drafted, if they think it may not go far enough. Specifically, the firm has said there's doubt will remain as to whether trustees can use a nominee custody structure or a sub-custodians. And again, I'd just be interested to get your view on this, both on the scope of section 19 and any potential risks identified in relation to it.
Well, section 19 is really a default provision. You can provide to the contrary in the trust deed quite easily, but it's a default power on trustees to make use of nominees for the purpose of exercising any of their powers. This is basically designed to provide the trustees with flexibility in administration. The general policy is discussed in Chapter 8 of the Law Commission report at paragraphs 8.11 onwards. As a matter of law, a nominee will normally be classified as a fiduciary, like a trustee. The power to appoint a nominee is constrained in Section 19. Subsection 3 imposes a trust on determined assets held by a nominee, irrespective of any purported agreement to the contrary, and any appointment is to be in the manner specified in subsection 7. So there is... This provision is quite prescriptive, but do bear in mind it's a default provision. A solicitor can, in a standard trust deed, change this. If a nominee is acting, the trustees must keep the relative arrangement under review. That's subsection 10. And there has been a bit of discussion about the position of client money, which is normally held... is regarded as held on trust. There was I had a dispute with Lord Hope, who expressed some views on Scots law in an English Lehman Brothers litigation some years ago, and I published an article in a collection of academic essays in honour of Professor George Gretton, disputing Lord Hope's interpretation of this. I think it is very important that things like client money should be held on trust by a nominee or however you designate the person. A nominee is basically a kind of trustee. That's the central point I'm trying to make here. To the extent that it's proposed that there could be changes to this legislation, which was discussed very extensively by the Law Commission, following consultation with members of the legal profession, I'd be quite happy to look at proposals for amendment of it and consider whether they would be suitable.
Okay. I think we seem to have lost Jeremy. Okay, we can come back to Jeremy on the, if he wants to come back in this point.
Yes.
Oh, Jeremy.
No, I've just changed. Thank you to for the kind offer. We may well come back to you on that offer. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm going to move on to sections 25 and 26, and we have received a variety of responses with regards to the issue regarding the provision of information under these sections. Certainly, there was especially some concern regarding the level of information that could be provided. And so with some comments from Anderson Strathairn, they expressed concerns that, and I quote, "We feel they have been drawn too widely and place too onerous a duty on trustees to provide information." And also Gillespie McAndrew LLP thought the provisions could open the door to increased litigation by disappointed potential beneficiaries for whom receipt of information on the existence of the trust might lead to an expectation of a benefit thereunder. In view of the comments that I've just read out and also others that we have received, does the Commission wish to offer any reflections on the policy underpinning these provisions at this stage?
Yes, the policy underpinning these decisions is discussed at some length, I may say, in Chapter 11 of the Commission's report, which is headed Information Duties. The particular problem was that there were really no express information duties in Scots law. We followed the, what you might call, the usual law reform technique of looking at law and following what they do. We did that quite extensively. It was obvious that in these other jurisdictions there were competing theories at paragraphs 11.8 onwards. These are discussed. The duties are quite complicated. We did seek views of members of the profession on these matters and took these comments into account. In the end of the day, there is a conflict between, I suppose, the trustee's interest in just getting on with the administration without being bothered. And at the same time, the interest that a beneficiary has to be told of his or her rights in the trust. This is an attempt at a compromise between these. On the whole, respondents were fairly content, I think, with what we proposed. The consultation responses are referred to at length in Chapter 11 of the report. It's quite a substantial chapter, and I'm not sure that I can really summarise what it says here. The it is always possible to I think this is in section 26 of the bill, for the trustor by express provision in the trust deed to limit or expand the trustee's statutory duty to provide information. I'd emphasise this is a default provision. It is not difficult for a solicitor to devise a form of trust deed that alters these duties in some way or other. Sorry, I'm trying to look at the text of the bill here.
Back to the issue of the information sharing with the bill that we have in front of us, do you think that that's it's fine as is proposed, or the concerns that have been raised by others, do you think that those concerns are warranted?
Sorry, I'm just trying to look at the actual terms of the bill as introduced here. Quite frankly, the basic duty to provide information is, if the trustees become aware that a person is a beneficiary, to inform that person that they're a beneficiary. I really don't see what the problem is with that. I don't see how you can avoid doing that. To do otherwise is simply to deny the fundamental right of the beneficiary to know that he or she is a beneficiary. That's what section 25 does. There's a duty to identify and trace beneficiaries. Again, that I think is fairly obvious.
I would suggest that's probably helpful for the moment.
Yes. Yes, 26 confers a certain degree of discretion on the trustees. This is 25 deals with the fact that a person is a beneficiary. 26 is the wider point about the terms of the trust. And it is, yes, subsection 2 there. Subsection 1 is subject to the express provisions of the trust deed and the rest of the section. So it is possible, solicitors are complaining about this, when they draft a trust deed, they can easily exclude the duty in section 26. They can't exclude the duty in section 25, but that's the fundamental policy decision that a person who is a beneficiary should be informed that they are a beneficiary. That I think, is perhaps self-evident.
Okay. No, thank you for that. Thank you. Certainly, that's, if you did have any further considerations on the section 25 and 26, if you wanted to provide that in writing afterwards, that would be very helpful.
Yeah.
Thank you. Question 12, over to Jeremy.
For our benefit, can you explain why the Commission decided to make the role of a supervisor optional in Chapter 6 when it is mandatory in many legal systems which permit private purpose trusts?
We didn't think it was necessary, basically. This was the contribution that is mentioned in the report from Dr. Patrick Ford of Dundee University, who is an expert on trust law. Private purpose, there's legislation permitting private purpose trusts in a number of jurisdictions. The one that we use as a kind of paradigm here is the so-called Star Trust legislation of the Cayman Islands. I may say the Cayman Islands, although they're an offshore jurisdiction, they are a reputable offshore jurisdiction, if I can put it that way. Their judges and lawyers are frequently Scots who have gone out there. I've known one or two people who have gone there or have been there, and it's not one of the more dubious jurisdictions. The Star legislation provides for a supervisor under the name of an enforcer. The word enforcer attracted critical comment for reasons that are fairly obvious if you know about the criminal underworld in the west of Scotland in particular. But we changed it to supervisor, which we think is what the person does. The private purpose trusts aren't recognised in English law. There's a case of 1804, Morris against the Bishop of Durham, which held that the only trusts recognised in English law are trusts to benefit named or identified persons, or trusts that are charitable in the technical sense of that word. And that's the concept of charity in those days was under an English statute of 1600. That's not an area that moved on very well. Purpose trusts are generally not used in English law, and the system, any system based on English law or English equity, had to provide express legislation. It was felt that enforcement was a problem, and the enforcer, the equivalent of the supervisor, was considered to be essential to make sure the trust could be enforced. What Patrick Ford pointed out to us is that in Scots law there's a well-established concept of interest to sue. In order to raise an action in court, you have to have title to sue in the sense of a legal title, and you must also establish that you have an interest to sue in the sense of some sort of pecuniary or proprietary interest in the outcome of the action. There must be an actual, it must make a difference to you. You can't raise abstract points. And we felt that ultimately this was the answer, that the concept of interest to sue allowed a range of people to enforce a purpose trust. If you don't have an interest to sue, of course, you can't go to court to enforce the trust, but there will be people with that interest. There are quite a lot of public purpose trusts at present. An example that I think I mentioned on the previous occasion we were here was the Nuclear Liabilities Fund, which is a purpose trust that covers the decommissioning of nuclear power stations throughout the United Kingdom. Scots law was chosen because Scots law permits purpose trusts. And we... it's one that's Scots law was chosen in that case. There are a number of other public purpose trusts in Scotland. They're not unusual at all, and these have been recognised for a very long time. The Law Commission took the view that these purpose trusts fulfil important functions in modern practice, because the trust is the standard method of ring-fencing funds for any particular purpose. That includes environmental purposes, which you get with the Nuclear Liabilities Fund. It can be a fund to identify used to identify a fund for a specific purpose in a commercial transaction, for example, snagging work in a construction contract, or providing a fund to make good the liabilities in a commercial development, such as a shopping centre. These can be extremely complex in their operation, and having a ring-fenced fund to pay for future liabilities can be very useful. Purpose trusts can be used to isolate and hold electronic material. Many of these are really public rather than private purpose trusts, but we couldn't see any real distinction between public trusts and private trusts in this respect. For example, the fund to meet environmental liabilities in a commercial development is technically a private trust, but it's a purpose trust, and it functions much the same way as the Nuclear Liabilities Fund. It's a way of meeting your environmental liabilities and making sure there are funds actually available to let you do that, because having funds readily available can be very important. So many of these so-called public purpose trusts were actually private in nature, because they were set up by private parties to fulfil their own purposes. As I say, it was decided that following the discussions with Dr. Ford, that we should make use of the concept of the of interest to sue, and that is how we thought we should proceed. We thought that private purpose trusts are almost certainly permitted under the existing Scots law. As I say, it's a very vague distinction between private and public purpose trusts. The Commission were slightly concerned, because a private purpose trust, a purpose trust of any sort, other than a charitable trust, is something that's not recognised by English law. And it has to be said that some English judges now in the UK Supreme Court have a rather bad record of failing to give effect to institutions that are distinctive in Scots law. We were concerned that something might be done to stop the creation of purpose trusts, and we were very concerned not to allow that to happen, because these are used so extensively in Scots law at present. That I hope explains why we thought we needed to authorise by legislation the use of private purpose trusts. We think it's probably strictly not necessary, but it's safer to do it.
Yep, that's absolutely fine. Thank you for that explanation. Helpful.
Jeremy, I think you wanted to come in on.
Yeah, just to further on, Mark, in regard to Chapter 7, extends to charitable trusts. For a charitable trust that will have a protector, can you explain how their powers and duties would sit alongside Austria's powers to regulate charitable trusts?
In charitable trusts, the primary regulation is going to be done by Ofsted. A protector is optional. The reason for permitting a protector is we think they exist already in Scots law. We think this is not innovating at all. We actually came across, as we prepared the report, one of the commissioners, Professor Hector McQueen, pointed out that George Herriot's trust, by which the school of that name was established in a trust in 1624, provided for a group of overseers who appear to have functioned in exactly the same way as a modern protector. So you can use the protector if you want to. I would have thought in charitable trusts it may not be a good idea. It's more in non-charitable trusts that you would want to use the protector, but we couldn't see any reason for excluding them from charitable trusts. In the end of the day, it's going to be the charities regulator who does most of the regulation there. But purpose trusts extend to many non-charitable purposes. I've given the Nuclear Liabilities Fund as one example. That's not charitable, but it is an important trust, fulfilling very important public purposes.
Okay, and that's very helpful. I wonder if I could just go a wee bit further on a separate issue. As you'll be aware, there is, as well as this bill, there is a charity bill going through the Scottish Parliament at the moment. And I wonder, and perhaps if you're not, then perhaps you could write to us. I wonder how you envisage Austria's administration power to appoint interim trustees to charitable trusts on Austria's own initiative under Section 8 of the Charity Bill will work with the court's power to appoint trustees under Chapter 1 of this bill. And I wonder, is there an interaction on the face of these two bills, or is there something that will cause some contradiction there?
I would be surprised if there were anything. Are you referring here particularly to the institution of the protector, or to the bill more generally?
Yes.
I don't think there's anything in the bill more generally. Oscar is concerned primarily with the application and enforcement of charity law, which is really a distinct area from trusts law. Nearly all charities are constituted as trusts, this bill is, as it were, the sort of ground on which the charities rest. I would be surprised if there were any real conflict. This is concerned with the basic legal structures that are used. Oscar's concerned with the application of charitable purposes. So there is a difference there, I think. To be conflict. There hasn't been in the past, but I will look at Section 8 in particular of the Charities Bill.
I'm grateful. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. And Bill.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener, and thank you very much, Lord Young. Section 61 of the Bill proposes that once a private trust has been in existence for 25 years, it can have its trust purposes altered on application to the Court of Session. Now, half of those whom the committee has asked for views, including the Faculty of Advocates, believe that this period of time is longer than necessary and think there should be a shorter minimum time period, or indeed in some cases some people say no time period at all before a court application could be made. Do you have any reflections on responses that the committee has received in this regard, please?
Yes, the Commission consulted in some detail on this matter. We were conscious of the fact that what is now Section 61 was novel, worldwide novel. We thought it deals with, in a sense, the problem of time and the law. You can't predict the future, as a wise person once said, never make predictions, especially about the future. That's, I think, supposed to have originated with the celebrated Danish physicist Niels Bohr, but he may have been quoting a Danish folk saying. It is difficult to predict the future, and that's what this is designed to do. To some extent, it corresponds to the CPRED jurisdiction that you get with public trusts, which is designed to deal with just this, changes of circumstances that haven't been foreseen. It became particularly acute with private trusts because the Law Commission decided that the existing limitations on the duration of private trusts should go. This is a movement that's been taking place in quite a number of jurisdictions throughout the world. Scotland was always fairly limited in its in the restrictions it placed on the duration of trusts. So it perhaps made it less of a change here that it did in some other jurisdictions, in the United States, for example, or New Zealand. But the result of this is that trusts could last for a very long period, and things can change, and it may be necessary to to change the trust purposes accordingly, to deal with the current situation of the family, if you take the case of a family trust. The general theory, which is expressed in the Commission's report, is the so-called dead hand argument. Members of the present generation shouldn't deprive succeeding generations of the power to do what they wish with trust property. It's socially desirable that the wealth of the world should be controlled by its living members and not by the dead. Those are the words of an celebrated American academic in this area, Professor Lewis M. Symes, writing, I think, in the 1950s. And in the light of this, we thought that provision should be made for changes in circumstances analogous to the existing CPRE jurisdiction. Examples of these are changes in the family itself. I mean, the Commission's report would give the examples of a disabled child is born, or some of the members of the family become mentally incapable, or the family need funds to provide, for example, for the a daughter's university education. That's an example that's given. There can be changes in the trust's financial circumstances. The analogy that I drew here was a case that I dealt with as the trust judge in the Court of Session, R.S. MacDonald's Charitable Trust. This is a charitable trust set up to provide for certain quite closely defined purposes many years before. Its main asset was the Glenmorangie Distillery. And in the, I think, the 1990s, the trustees sold the Glenmorangie Distillery for a vast sum of money. It was one of the last privately owned malt distilleries, and they received a vast increase in their funds, and something had to be done about this. And that was what was at issue there, to provide for suitable disposal of the funds. The financial circumstances of the family made change in respect of needs or resources. A breadwinner may lose his or her job. I mentioned the need to send a daughter or son through university. A great number of things can change, and this is designed to provide that flexibility. It's under the control of the court, because well, it does involve a very radical change in the trust. As to the duration, the Commission consulted on this. One thing I was very conscious of was that this was a novel jurisdiction. I didn't know how it was going to go down. I was very pleasantly surprised by the favourable response. But 25 years really reflected a fairly lengthy default provision. You can always change that in a trust deed. You can make it if you think that you, if you like the policy in this section, you can provide for 10 years, 5 years, whatever you like. It will always be under the control of the of a judge, so that you have to persuade the judge that there has actually been a change of circumstances. But
do you mind if I send? I mean, does that mean that although Section 61's proposal for 25 years is there, and that before you could apply to the Court of Session, that wouldn't necessarily be the case in real?
Yes, I think I'm just trying to look through the section here. Yes, it's subsection 4B, mm-hmm. Paragraph C of subsection 3, that's the 25-year provision. Paragraph C is to apply with the substitution for the reference to 25 years of a reference to a shorter period of time being a period specified in the deed. So the trust deed can quite readily provide for less than 25 years.
That's really helpful. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
As I say, there was an element of compromise here, and we didn't want the default period to be too short, because some people like the idea of continuing certainty and trust. So we felt 25 was, as it were, a reasonable compromise here, and you can always change it in a particular trust.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. And Oliver.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask about litigation expenses, and in particular the Law Society's concerns about Section 65. The Law Society quite outspoken on this, citing a severe danger of a conflict of interest, and they describe it as quite a radical provision, basically suggesting that it may deter people from becoming trustees or lead them to unfavourable settle or abandon legal proceedings for fear of personal liability. Do you have any comments in response?
Well, we looked at this is discussed in detail in chapter 16 of the Commission's report, paragraphs 1622 to 1637. I may say these particular provisions followed two earlier discussion papers, one on liability of trustees to third parties and a second on supplementary and miscellaneous issues relating to trust law. There is a certain analogy with companies here, but the trouble is with a company, you know what its financial position is to some degree by looking at the company's register. The central point here is really that normally the expenses will be recoverable from the trust property without liability on the part of the trustee. If the trust property is insufficient, the trustees will be personally liable from their own property. But this is subject to a provision in subsection 6 that the court may, if it considers that it would be unfair not to do so, relieve a trustee of personal liability for certain expenses. This was thought to strike a fair balance among the competing interests, in particular those of the trustees and those of a party engaged in litigation with the trust. In these matters, inevitably, there is a degree of compromise and uncertainty. You can't avoid that. The issues, as I say, are discussed in that passage in the Commission's report at paragraph 1622 onwards.
Recognise, I guess, the risk for parliamentarians in the Parliament in seeking to proceed with legislation where, I mean, the Law Society's, you know, is it, I mean, if you read, you know, their submission as a whole, you know, it's generally quite discursive. But, you know, when I see severe danger of a conflict of interest, radical provision, real issues, you know, it starts to worry me, you know, on an individual level that the balance might not be quite right, and they also point out that non-recovery is a standard risk of litigation. And I guess I'm thinking of examples you know, where people are take on roles within charitable trusts, sort of other things, you know, not really expecting, you know, that their own, you know, personal property is going to become at risk if they, you know, if they proceed with litigation. And I hear what you're saying, that the court sort of may, but I guess if you're taking, you know, any kind of legal advice, there's always going to be a risk with that, and I'm just trying to satisfy myself that it is the right balance.
I haven't, as far as I'm aware, seen what the Law Society actually wrote on this. Well, what they say suggests to me that they've it sounds rather exaggerated, because expenses are always ultimately under the control of the court, and this is one of the reasons, of course, for trying to focus trust litigation on the trust judges, because they are aware of all of these matters and the need to strike a balance here. In the end of the day, you have to strike a balance, and the balance is very specific to the individual case. There are cases where trustees behave unreasonably. Normally they won't, if they act in accordance with proper legal advice, that the risk of that, I think, is pretty minimal. But the
they suggest, you know, the sort of starting point or the principle should be that trustees should not have any personal liability unless it can be shown that it's fair for them to be liable. So I guess they're suggesting flipping it, almost flipping that point around, and that you know that from you know without sort of unfairly summarising their position, you know, from my reading of it, it seems you know that they're suggesting you know that the actual principle is you know that the principle is wrong, that personal liability should be introduced.
Well, that's. If you look at subsection 1 of section 65, the basic rule is subject to the following provisions. A trustee does not incur personal liability for the expenses of civil litigation to which the trust is party. So the exactly what the law society are wanting. Subsection 2 deals with this position where trust property is insufficient to meet the expenses. Then the excess is recoverable from the personal property of the trustees. Well, quite frankly, if trustees get engaged in complicated litigation when there's hardly any trust property, that's what we're talking about here, then they ought to draw that to people's attention and possibly drop out of the litigation at that point. Subsection 3 deals with litigation which is, in the opinion of the court, unnecessary. Certain specialised areas involving a judicial factor. A trustee is opposing the reduction of the trust deed and the trustee is unsuccessful. Ultimately, of course, there is a discretion. There's always a discretion in the court in litigation expenses. The trustee has, by breach of duty, brought about the litigation. Well, that's liable to be negligence as a trustee. That's what the breach of duty means there. E deals with a rather specialised case where there's a minority that litigate against the wish of the majority and do so unsuccessfully. Well, again, that's one where there are very special circumstances. Likewise, F, that's where a minority of trustees don't consult the other trustees, and without the defence being of any benefit to the trust. A trustee who takes proper legal advice and behaves in a responsible manner shouldn't be under any difficulty from this. I'm slightly surprised that the Law Commission, the Law Society response here. If I could be sent a copy of that, I'd be very happy to respond to it in detail. As I say, this is dealt with at some length in Chapter 16, paragraph 1622 onwards of the Law Commission report.
The submission's sort of on the Parliament website, but I'm sure the committee clerks would be happy to send it to you. I'd certainly be interested, I'm sure the committee as a whole would be, if you wanted to review this specific points they make. It just seemed, you know, having seen lots of their submissions on various legislation, the comments in this section seemed in quite strong terms.
Yes.
So any feedback you had would be gratefully appreciated.
I should say, paragraph 1632 of the Commission's report, this is the report, the result of the consultation, which I think was in, I think this may have been in a separate consultation paper, actually. Respondents, including the Faculty of Advocates and the judges of the Court of Session, agreed with the general structure of our proposals. The Law Society was concerned that imposing personal liability on trustees in the first instance would mean in practice that trustees would hardly ever dare to litigate. They thought that exclusion of personal liability should be the norm. The advisory group indicated that it should be made clear that currently trustees normally have a right of relief against the trust estate if they're found liable for litigation expenses, that this should be made clear in the report. 1633, in the light of those comments, the scheme was revised so that a trustee does not normally incur personal liability for the expenses of litigation to which the trust is a party. That's what subsection 1 actually says. We consider that the following recommendations deal with the concern expressed by our advisory group. that a trustee should normally have a right of relief against the trust's estate if he or she is found liable for litigation expenses. The normal position is that the trustee doesn't incur personal liability, but will only do so if a court order is made to that effect. In the latter situation, following a court order to that effect, it will normally be inappropriate for the trustee to have any right of recourse against the trust estate, but express power is given by a recommendation to allow the trustee relief against the trust property in some circumstances, if the court agrees. The court is given a residual power, that I think is subsection 5, to relieve a trustee of personal liability for expenses. So there are a considerable number of safeguards built in here. The danger is, on one hand, you have the trustee who litigates irresponsibly. It's not common, but it does happen occasionally. On the other hand, the Commission were quite clear that the norm should be that a trustee doesn't incur personal liability, and that's precisely what the bill does. I mean, it is important to read these sections carefully and to see what the norm is and what provisions deal with exceptional situations.
I think part of the policy concern stems from the fact there are lots of people interacting with trusts who are maybe not as familiar with the law, not as familiar with court proceedings. You know, and if you're looking at taking on responsibilities on behalf of a small charitable trust, or people who interact with trusts, that will be relatively modest. The concept or the fact that you may become personally liable, is something that might put people off. I mean, I guess that's the point that's been made.
Yes, I mean, if you actually know about the law, this shouldn't be a problem for you. I mean, I'm a trustee of charitable trusts. I'm aware of the problem you mention. I'm on occasion drafted onto the trust because they want someone with a bit of legal knowledge on the trust. I think if trustees behave responsibly and take proper advice, it shouldn't be a problem. I accept that with very small trusts, there may be a reluctance to take elaborate legal advice. There could be problems there, yeah. But, I mean, again, the norm is that the trustee doesn't incur personal liability. That's section 65.1. And I think the Law Society have rather lost sight of that central point. In addition to that, of course, litigation expenses are under the control of the court.
I'll ask one final question, and just was whether... I'm just thinking, as you've been answering the questions, whether there's any, do you think there'd be any merit in kind of something further on the face of the bill for smaller trusts or trusts that are charitable, in terms of some sort of exemption from personal liability where people are acting in a charitable capacity or where the trust is relatively modest.
The danger with that is it gives the trustees carte blanche to do what they want. If there is no liability, the trustee can really do what he or she wants. And there is the danger that someone behaves in a completely irresponsible fashion. It is open to trustees. This is somewhere else in the bill. It's open to them to relieve trustees of liability for negligence, but not gross negligence. There is a division that's traditionally been drawn in Scots law between ordinary negligence and gross negligence. This has been the subject of repeated criticism by English judges because English law doesn't recognise that distinction. For example, in a recent case involving, I think it was Jersey, it might have been Guernsey, that the law there did have provisions dealing with gross negligence, and English judges and they sitting in the Privy Council were very critical of the notion of gross negligence, and they didn't see there was any difference from ordinary negligence. The difference, I think, is a very clear one. Gross negligence is a situation where the trustee just doesn't do anything about their duties as trustee. And it doesn't bother me particularly that you shouldn't be able to exempt people from that liability. In some cases, it's getting close to fraud, and clearly you can't exempt a trustee from liability for fraud. As always, it's a question of drawing a line. Okay. We felt at the Commission that what we provided here gives trustees fair and reasonable protection and shouldn't serve as a disincentive. I would like to read what the Law Society say and reconsider matters in the light of that.
Thank you. Okay, no, thank you. I'm sure certainly this particular aspect of the bill, we'll come back to this in further questioning, and also Lord Drummond Younger, once you've had a look at the Law Society submission. Yep. If you wanted to provide some further comments to the committee in writing, that would be very helpful.
Yes.
Thank you. And moving on to Mercedes.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to move us on to the part of the bill that deals with succession, section 72. So in policy terms, the definition of spouse or civil partner includes a spouse or civil partner that the deceased person was separated from, but where no divorce or dissolution of the civil partnership had taken place. So this means that a spouse or civil partner in that circumstance could benefit from section 72 of the bill on the right to inherit. So the Law Society and various other respondents to the committee's call for views have said that they would like to see a distinction drawn between spouses or civil partners who were living with the deceased person at the time of their death and those spouses or civil partners who'd previously separated from the deceased person but had not divorced or had the partnership dissolved. So we'd be keen to hear the Commission's response to that suggestion.
Could you give us just a moment to confer on this?
I'll suspend the session just for a few moments.
Thank you, David.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, and welcome back.
We want to apologise for being unable, really, to give you any views about these succession sections in the Act. What has happened is, I believe the Scottish Law Commission produced a succession report some years ago, but it is the Scottish Government which has grappled with this difficult question, which has just been put, where the essence is an undivorced spouse who hasn't been living with the other spouse for, say, 20 years. What's the position there, especially if there's a cohabitant? I'm afraid the Commission haven't looked into this recently. It is a purely Scottish Government consultation, we understand, possibly run by Jill Clark and Alison Mason, and it drew very polarised views and strong responses. So it hasn't been discussed, this difficult issue, at the Commission recently at all. In fact, not at all. Would you agree with that, Lord Drummond?
Yes, the Commission report on which these sections are based is it predates my time as chairman of the Commission. It's quite a long time ago. It may be that the people who were commissioners then, they've all changed since, can help on this, but I would find it very difficult to contribute anything significant. I can understand what the concern.
Mercedes?
I think it's something we'll need further consideration.
Sure. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I just say that if you thought that was controversial, then I think this last one possibly might be. Part two of the bill doesn't contain a blanket ban on unlawful killer from being an executor. As the law is not clear in this area, two academics, lawyers, Dr. Alistair McPherson and Professor Roddy Paisley of the University of Aberdeen, have suggested that part two of the bill could be used to clarify the law in this area. This could include, of course, that the unlawful killer is the partner or husband or wife of the deceased and then would become the executor in the will. And this has raised a lot of concerns. I wonder what you've got to say about that.
I personally share the concerns, and again, I have to say, from the point of view of the Scottish Law Commission, it's not been discussed there because it hasn't been part of any project. It could be referred, I suppose, to the Commission, but I agree that there are serious concerns arising out of the scenario you've painted.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'd agree with that. I think it's something that the courts probably wouldn't have very much difficulty with. There are very strong public policy arguments here for restricting the rights of people convicted of unlawful killing. And, for example, a beneficiary under a will could never benefit if they had unlawfully killed the testator. You've got to be slightly careful about unlawful killing because, I mean, it goes down, I suppose, in some respects to causing death by careless driving. You can imagine where a wife is killed through her husband's careless driving, a tragic situation where it clearly wasn't intended. That's a totally different thing from the sort of unlawful killing you're talking about here. It's really murder, couple homicide, and that sort of thing that you're concerned about. If I were sitting in court, I wouldn't have very much difficulty dealing with this if it were brought before me. But that won't happen now. It may be that something could be put in. I'd agree with that, but I'm not prepared for it just now.
Sure. Thank you very much indeed. That's fine. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Do we have any further questions for the panel? No. Okay, thank you. So with that, can I thank Lady Payton and Lord Drummond-Young for their extremely helpful evidence this morning. The committee may follow up by letter with any additional questions stemming from today's meeting. But also, I think there are a couple of action points for yourselves to come back to the committee on also. So,
can I just check? I mean, I have noted down one or two points. And what we would like to know is, should we await your request or further questions, or should we, for example, fulfil an undertaking? Because certainly there's one undertaking that we were going to send you the correspondence and dialogue between the Scottish Government and Westminster about the Section 104 request. So I take it you would like that followed up without a further question from yourself, or are you going to send us perhaps a letter with five requests in it?
Yeah, no, so we will certainly write to yourselves to confirm.
Oh, well, that would be very helpful. Thank you very much.
It would be helpful if it would be comprehensive. I'm conscious that, for example, I've undertaken to make available, I think, the text of the talk that I gave
on green investment,
if I can put it that way. Yeah. And it's fairly short, I'm happy to say, but it does explain how it's possible to even to work around the existing legislation.
We'll await a letter requesting.
Indeed.
Thank you very much.
No problem at all.
Well, it's been a pleasure discussing trusts with you, and I take it then that's the end of the proceedings.
Once again, I'd like to thank the both of you for coming along, and I will now suspend the meeting briefly to allow our witnesses to leave the room. So, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.